Okay, so good morning everybody. Today we discuss about the channel coding, and in channel coding we will learn about the error correcting codes. Basically three kind of error correcting codes that we are going to address in three consecutive lecture. One is known as a linear block code. Then in the next lecture we'll discuss about the cyclic code, and from next to next lecture we'll discuss about the convolution code. Channel coding is a method in which the error correcting codes are appended in your information bit. To increase the reliability in the system, so if receiver is getting a information bit, receiver is totally blind to check whether the received information is correct or it may encounter with some error between transmitter and receiver propagation. So here it is essential that receiver should locate the error, should identify the error, and then it correct the error. So for the correction, very essential part is to locate the error, and error correcting codes will help the receiver to locate the error, and then finally consecutively the receiver is able to detect and correct the error. So this is a very important part, and for various error correcting codes like the linear block code, cyclic code and convolution code are basically designed in a way to increase the reliability of the system and decrease the bit error rate at the receiver. So the first part we are going to learn today is a linear block code. And here it is written, error correcting codes are appended with your information bits to detect and correct the error at the receiver. But if we are appending such kind of error correcting codes at the end of an information bit, so obviously the redundancy will increase and the code efficiency will goes down. So there is a trade-off between reliability of the system and code efficiency. Both cannot be achieved simultaneously. We will even discuss about this part later stage. Here, this block diagram will tell us how the received bit is encounter with a error. So let's consider there is a channel encoder. Channel encoder is a place where the encoding of your information bit is to be done. So input would be your data word. After passing through the channel encoder, it will be converted as a code word. So code word can be defined as a C. So code word consists the error correcting code plus information bits. They are transmitted through the channel, and noise is basically added by this portion channel. Then your receive bit is not only the data which is transmitted, it is the data which has been transmitted in form of a code word added with this error E. So E is actually the subscription for error. So now receiver bit is to be contained with code word C and error E. That would be given as input to the channel decoder. Channel decoder will do this reverse process of channel encoder. It will be try to decode the received data which is contained by the error and try to absorb the original data D back. So it try to restore the original data back. So this part has been done by the receiver decoder, which is located at the receiver side. So this is the whole part. Now here the major trade-off is the error correcting code work well to increase the reliability of a system and to reduce the bit error rate or probability of error, but at the same time it also reduces the efficiency of data, because here we are not transmitting only the data but we are transmitting the extra bit with the data, and that will increase the redundancy of your information, and that will consecutively reduce the efficiency of data. But at the same time, it increases the reliability of your data. This is a good factor. So this trade-off you need to note down. So first we are going to start with the linear block code, and in today's lecture we will address only the encoding process of linear block code, and in next lecture I will try to address the decoding of a linear block code. So in a linear block code, there are this whole block is known as a code word. This whole block is itself known as a code word. So this whole block consists of basically two part. The first k bits up to 1 to k bits, these bits are known as information bits, and the extra bits are appended at the end, and these bits are known as check bit or error correcting bits. So if we assume the total number of bits are n, the total number of bits are this code word is defined as a c1 c2 up to cn. So the total number of bits here are n, and out of this n bits, the k bits, this bits k bits are the information bits, and the remaining bits are known as a check bits. So that there are m bits are the check bits. M is equal defined as the total number of bit minus k number of bits. So here this thing is clear, that the code word is of a length of n bits. Out of this n bits, the k bits are information bits, and remaining m is equal to n minus k bits are the error correcting bits. So the code word is same as your data bit up to the k number of bit. Here the c1 is equal to d1, the c2 is equal to d2, up to ck is equal to dk, up to the kth bit, the ck, the code word and the data word are same, they are exactly identical up to the k number of bit. But from k plus 1 bit to the n bit, the code word is a different. The code word from ck plus 1 to cn, all the bits from ck plus 1 to cn bits can be obtained by the linear combination of the data bits. So this code is known as a linear block code, because here the block is performed which consists the data plus the error correcting codes and the m bits, the remaining m bits means from k plus 1 to n, those all the bits of a code word can be obtained or produced by the linear combination of the data words. So that is the important portion. So we can say the code word can be defined as a C1. C1 is the first bit of the code word. C2 is considered as a second bit of a code word up to CN. So there are n number of bits are there, and the length L1 is n. The data word is simply defined by the bits or information bits. There can be defined by the vector D. D1 is the first bit of information, D2 is the second bit of information, and up to the DK, where DK is the kth bit of information. And the length of this data word is simply defined by K. So L2 is the length of data vector and it is K. So remaining bits are known as error correcting bits or check bits. We'll see the procedure how the remaining bits or error correcting bits can be obtained by the linear combination of data bits in the same lecture. So the error correcting bits or check bits are simply the total number of check bits are n, that is n minus k, where again k, n is the total length of a code word, k is the information bits. So in encoding process which has been performed at the transmitter side, we are converting data vector to the code vector. Or this code vector is transmitted. This code vector is to be modified by the error, and then we are getting the receive vector at the receiver. This receive vector is passed through the channel decoder and produce the same code vector or data vector at the output, and that will go for the further process. So this part we need to learn. So as shown here, the code word has the total length n bits, and out of n bits, the first k bits of a code word are identical to the data word. So the first bit of code word is C1 is equal to the first bit of data bit D1. the second bit of a code word C2 is equal to the second bit of a data D2. So in the similar fashion, the kth bit of code word, the last bit is of data is the DK. So kth bit of code word CK is identical to the kth bit of data vector DK. So here this is shown over here. This part is shown. The first bit of code vector is equivalent to data vector first bit D1, then same for C2 and D2 up to CK and DK. So these are the same. So here we can say the K bit of code vector are identical to K. Okay, so first K bit of data vector, code vector are identical to the K bits of data vector. Okay, now we come to the K plus 1 bit. So here the K plus 1 bit of code vector to the nth bit, they are obtained by the linear combination of data bits. So this one CK plus 1 can be obtained by H11. H11 is the coefficient which can have the value of 1 or 0. So it can have only two value, 1 or 0. So here H11 is multiplied with the first data vector bit D1. Then H12 is multiplied with the second bit data vector. Then H1K can be multiplied with the kth bit of data vector. So this is the linear combination. This one is the linear combination of data vector, and then it will be produce a K plus 1 bit of code vector. With the similar way, the K plus 2 bit of code vector can be obtained with H21D1 plus this is considered as a XOR operation, XORing with the H22 into D2 up to the last one would be H2K into DK. And the last bit of data code vector CN can be obtained as HM1 into D1 XORing with HM2 D2 up to HMK DK, where D1 D2 up to DK are the particular bit of data vector, and H11 H12 H21 H22 are the coefficient which is multiplied with the data vector to produce a new combination of a code vector. And this value of this coefficients belongs to 1 and 0 only. So we can say over here that hij is belongs to 0 and 1 only. It doesn't have any third value. It can have a 0 or 1 only. Now if this all the equations can be written in form of a matrix, so we can say the first k bit of data vector is equivalent to the first k bits of a code vector is equivalent to the first k bit of data vector. So in a matrix it should be multiplied with identity matrix, and then it produces the same result. So at the left side of equation there is a vector, and this vector is known as a code vector, code word vector. And the right side there is a multiplication of a data vector. So this is a data vector which consists of all the bit from first bit to the kth bit, and there is a matrix. In this matrix the first part, if we can observe here, is the identity matrix. So if data vector is multiplied with the identity matrix, they are produced the same data vector, and that can be assigned to the first k bit. So the size of identity matrix should be considered as a k cross k. It means they have a k row and k column, and all the diagonal elements of this identity matrix are 1, and all other components of this identity matrix are 0. The remaining portion of the matrix are the coefficient. So here the d1 is multiply with h11, d2 is multiply with h12. So this is the row of data vector, and the same here, there are the column. So we can say h11 is multiply with d1, h12 is multiply with the d2, and h1k can be multiply with the dk. So that will be produced. This is the responsible to produce a ck plus 1. The multiplication of this all the coefficient, multiplication with this all the this coefficients, and multiplication of this data vector will produce a ck plus 1. Then the multiplication, then the second one. So if you multiply the second column h21, h22 up to h2k here, this is multiply with the data vector d1 to dk, and that is responsible to produce a ck plus 2 code vector, means k plus 2 bit of the code vector. Then up to the last one, hm1 up to hmk, this is the column, this produce a c, is multiply with this data vector, and they will produce a cn, nth bit of a code vector. So that way we can produce all other combinations of a code vector, or the all the combinations after k plus 1 bit to the n bit of a code vector. Now here, so this, if you observe this matrix, so this matrix is basically have a two part. The first part is the identity matrix, which size is a k cross k. And the second part is known as a parity matrix. The identity matrix consists the all the diagonal elements of matrix are 1 and all other elements are 0. And this is the parity matrix. The parity matrix size is k cross n. This consists of all the coefficient which has been multiplied over here with your data vector. So there is a two part, and this whole matrix consisting identity matrix and parity matrix are known as a G matrix, known as a generator matrix. The matrix or vector which has only the data parts, this is considered as a D matrix. So this is the D matrix, this one is the D matrix, and this matrix which has only the code part, so this matrix is known as a C matrix. So we have a C is equal to D into G, where D is a data vector matrix here, G is generate, we can say this one is a data vector. So D is not only single value, it's an array of multiple values. The k values are kth up to c, d1 to dk. So k bit, it's a vector of a k bit. C is also a vector, it's known as a code vector. It consists of c1 to cn, so nth bit, it consists of n bit. And G is the generator matrix with the size of k cross m. K cross M. So this can be defined as a C is equal to D into G. D is a code vector, C is a code vector, D is a data vector, and G is a generator matrix. Now we have to learn some special characteristic of this generator matrix. So generator matrix consists of two parts, which has been shown over here. The first part is a identity matrix of k size is simply means is a size is simply defined as a k cross k. So k row and k columns are there. This matrix is identity matrix. The second part of this same matrix is known as a parity matrix. A parity matrix size is k cross n. Now all the elements of this parity matrix, all the coefficients of parity matrix hij, I and j may take any value, and this all this parity matrix components belongs to 0 and 1. It may be either 0 or 1 only. G matrix is the main matrix which is to be designed at the time whenever the system is to be formed out or system is to be constructed, transmitter and receiver is to be constructed. And G matrix is a common between transmitter and receiver. So once the transmitter side, the G matrix is defined, the same information is said to the receiver. So receiver can store this G matrix in their memory, and for a further processing of a decoding of a linear block code, the same G matrix can be used in another form. So here we can say the code vector C is simply defined as a D into G. Now G, it can be consist a two portion, identity matrix and parity matrix. So if D is multiplied to this, the first part D multiply with identity matrix, and then the second one, and secondly the D is multiply with the parity matrix P. So this DP is given a special name as a CP. So DP is replaced with this name is a CP, and D here in the first place the D is multiplied with identity matrix, so produce the same matrix D. So C basically consists the two part, the D is and the CP. It's D is simply state the first few bits of code words are the matrix D, and the remaining bits of a code word can be produced with a linear combination of the data vector, and this portion is known as a CP portion. So the system designer is free to select the any matrix Z as per the requirement, but it must be shared between transmitter and receiver. Whenever encoding is to be done, the transmitter is using the particular G matrix, but the same matrix is to be shared to the receiver also. So during the decoding process, the receiver is trying to decode the information using the same G matrix. So matrix G should be a common between transmitter and receiver. Then and then the encoding and decoding process of linear block code is successful. And the size of a code can be defined as a n comma k, where the first number n represent the length of code word, and the next number represent the length of data word. So there is one example. In this example, it has been shown there are two data vectors are given as a 001 and another data vector as a 111. The matrix G is provided. The size of a code is a 6,3. 6,3 means that the total code word length is 6, and among the 6, the 3 bits are a data vector bit, and the remaining 3 bits are the error correcting bits or check bits. So it has been asked, if this information is provided, like data vectors, two data vectors are given, the code length is given as a 6,3, generator matrix is provided, and it has been asked to find the code word for a data vector. So we need to find the two code word. The first code word we have to find for data vector C, so data vector D1, and the second we have to find for a data vector D2. Or here we can say, first we are going to start for this data vector. Either you may write a D1, or we can simply write as a D. This is also D. Let's say D only. And here also we will replace this one with D only. So the solution of this problem is, the first is given n comma k is equal to 6,3. So this n is 6 and k here is 3. The total length of code word is indicating as a 6, and the length of a data vector is considered as a 3, and the remaining 3 bits are check bits. The equations we are following is a C can be obtained with a D vector multiplying with a G matrix. And we will choose the first vector as a D as a 001. So as per this equation, C is equal to D into G. This one has been chosen over here, 001, and it is multiplied with the matrix G. So this is the vector D and this is the matrix G. Now here we will do the simple matrix operation here, but the condition is between two elements. We are using generally the addition operation in our linear mathematics, but here we are using XORing operation. So not a addition operation. So we can say, if this the first bit we can obtain here the various code vector bits c1 to cn. So there are how many bits are produced here? So k is given as 3. So the length of this data vector is 3 bits, and the code vector is of a 6 bit. So there are c1 to c6 bits are there. So total 6 bits are there of a code vector. So first bit we are producing here in this fashion. This data vector is multiplied with the matrix G. Now this first row operator vector is to be multiplied with the first column of your matrix G. So there is a multiplication of a first element with the first element of a first column, right? This is the first column. So first column, this is the, we can say, second column. This one will return us, this operation will return us a C1, this operation will return us a C2, and so forth. Then the first element of vector D is multiplied with 0 into 1. So that is here, 0 into 1. Then the second element of a data vector is multiplied with the second element of a first column. So that is 0 into 0. That will produce here, 0 into 0. Then the third element of data vector is 1, which is multiplied with the third element of your first column of a matrix G, which is simple multiply with 1, and here there is a 0, so that would be a 1 and a 0. This operation is complete, and this will give us the first bit of your code vector C1. Now we repeat with the second one. So in a second one, what can happen here? We assume this is the second column. We repeat this operation for a second bit of your code word. So first bit of your data vector 0 is to be multiplied with the first bit of your second column. So that is 0 into 0. It's here. Then the second bit of your data vector is to be multiplied with here, the second bit of your second column matrix G. So that is the 0 here, and that is 1 over here, so that is multiplied with the 0 into 1. Then the third bit of your data vector is 1, which is multiplied with the third bit or third component of the second column of your matrix G. So that is 1 into 0. So that is 1 into 0. There is a XORing operation between all these components. So this operation is simply XOR or in OR operation, and all these operations are XORing operation. So this will give a code word C2. Now to obtain the code word C3 here, what we can do, we multiply the data vector with the element to element of the C3 column of matrix C. Then we obtain the C4 by multiplying the data vector with the fourth column. With the fifth column will produce a C5, and C6 can be produced by multiplying the data vector element to element with the sixth column of your generator matrix G. So here we are getting, this will give us a C3, this will give us a C4, this will give us a C5, and this will give us a C6. So there are six bits of a code vector can be obtained. Now here 0 into 1, here this is elaborate here, 0 into 1 would be produce a 0, then 0 into 0 would produce a 0, then 1 into 0 would produce a 0. And if you're applying the XORing operation between this 3, so it will be produce a 0. The same can be obtained here. The 0 into 0 would be a 0. Here also we can have the same thing, 0. Then 0 into 1, if you obtain, there would be a 0. 1 into 0 would be a 0. And XORing between this 3 will produce again a 0. Now for a C3 code, 0 into 0, 0, 0 into 0, 0, 1 into 1, 1. So that is same here, 0, 0, 1. And that will be produce a 1. And if you apply for all the bits here, this is the C1, C2, C3, C4, C5, and this is C6. And if the same operation can be simplified, so we can get here the first bit is the C1 bit, the C2 bit, then it would be C3 bit, then the C4 bit, C5 bit, and C6 bit. And this whole is basically a code vector. Corresponding to the data vector 001. So this is the corresponding data vector 001, and with corresponding to this data vector, we are getting this code word. Now the same we can repeat for the another data vector 111. So the procedure is same. The code vector C is equal to data vector D. This is the D is a 111. This matrix G is the identical to the earlier matrix which has been given to us or which has been formed over here. Then we do the same operation. So this will give a C1. So we can multiply 1 with the 1. The first element of your first column is 1. Multiply with the first element of your data vector 1 into 1. So that will give us this value 1 into 1. Then we have this one. Multiply with the second element of your first column 0. So 1 into 0 will give us the 1. This one 1 into 0. Then the third element of data vector is 1. Multiply with the third element of your column, first column, so that is 1 into 0, reproduce 1 into 0, right? So if 1 into 1 would be 1, 1 into 0 would be 0, and this one 1 into 0 would be 0, and if we are providing the XORing operation, we are getting the first bit. So this is the C1, this is C1, this is the C1. Similar to obtain the C2, what we can do here, we can multiply the second column element to element with the elements of a data vector. So the first element 1 is multiplied with this 0, then the second will be multiplied with this 1, and the third will be multiplied with 0. Then you are getting the C2 code vector, and this is 1 into 0, 1 into 1, 1 into 1, 1 into 0, and then finally, we can simplify it here as the C2 code vector, right? That is 1 into 0, 0, 1 into 1, 1, and 1 into 0, 0. And if you're providing the XORing operation, so that is equivalent to this code vector C2. And similar fashion, we are getting all this 6 code vector. So this one is finally, we have obtained, this is the code vector corresponding to the data vector D is equal to 111. Right. So if we can find the code vector for all the data vector, then this table can be created. So this table will show if your data vector would be a 111, we are getting the code vector as a 111000. You can note down the first k bit of your code vector are exactly identical the first k bit of your data vector, but the remaining 3 bits can be obtained with a linear combination of this data vector. The same for a 110 data bit, we can find the code word as a 110110. Here we can note down here the first k bit are similar to your code vector, and any code you can choose from here, let's say 000. So first 3 bits of your code word are identical to the data vector, and remaining 3 bits can be obtained with the combination of a linear combination of your data vector. So this is the part you need to learn. So this is the encoding process where the data vector is to be converted to the code vector by using the generator matrix. Now, what is the capacity, error correcting capacity? This is the next topics that we are going to address. So error correcting capacity is defined how many bits can be corrected by this code. Maybe possible the noise is very high and all 3 bits may be changed. Maybe possible the noise is bit less and only 2 bits are going to change, or maybe a single bit is going to change. Maybe possible there is you are lucky enough and you are getting error free communication, and whatever you are transmitting the same is received, there is no error. But so the capacity is basically defined how many bits, maximum bits, can be detected and corrected correctly by the receiver using this code. So it is generally defined in terms of a up to how much error means the maximum error can be corrected. So basically it depends on the Hamming distance between the code. So whatever the code word over here, we have to find the minimum Hamming distance. So minimum Hamming distance topic is, I think, cover earlier, but let's repeat here. For example, if your x1 vector is 10110 and x2 vector is 01010. Now the Hamming distance is defined how many bits are not match or how many bits are differ between the two data vector x1 and x2. So we have to consider 1 to 1. So we will first check for a first bit, they are mismatched, they are not the same. These are also mismatch, this is also mismatch. The fourth bit is same, 1 and 1, so we'll not consider it. The fifth bit is also same, we'll not consider it. So there are 3 bits are deeper between the given sequence. So the Hamming distance, this d is Hamming distance, is considered as a 3. So Hamming distance is simply the number of bits which are deeper between two given sequence. We will check for a bit to bit. So first bit of first sequence will be compared with the first bit of second sequence. The second bit of a first sequence can be compared with the second bit of a second sequence, and so forth. And identify the number of bits which are deeper between the two sequence. And this is known as a Hamming distance. So here we need to say, if d minimum is known as a minimum Hamming distance, is the minimum Hamming distance. So we can pick up any two code, or we can find the first code with the second, third, fourth, fifth, sixth. There are 8 possibilities are there, because there are 3 bits, so 8 code word data word can be produced, and the similarly 8 code word can be produced. So we can check the first with all other 7, the second with all remaining 7, and so forth, and we find the minimum distance, Hamming distance. So if you compare this one, we can find the minimum Hamming distance here is 11100110110. So you say this one is first bit is same, so we will not choose. The second is even same, but the third bit here, that is a difference. Third bit is 1 in the first sequence and 0 in second sequence, so they are not same. Fourth bit is also deeper, 0 and 1. And the fifth bit is also deeper, 0 and 1. And the last one is same. So you can choose in this fashion, you can do for all. So you can basically find here the d minimum distance is the three places where the bit are mismatched. The Hamming distance is found as a 3. So d minimum can be considered as a 3. So this equation will tell d minimum is the minimum Hamming distance you can find between any two code. T is the error correcting capacity. Error correcting capacity is basically in terms of a number of bits. So whatever the value of t, the error correcting code is capable to correct that much number of error. So, or you can say the error correcting code is capable to correct up to the t number of bits. So we have to find the number of t, because it will directly give us the how many number of bits can be corrected by this error correcting code, or directly depends on the error correcting capability of the code. So in the present scenario, we have found d minimum is equal to 3. We place in this above equation, so 3 is equal to 2t plus 1, and if you find this equation in form of a t by doing some simple mathematics, so t can be considered as a 1. It simply means this present code can provide a maximum 1 bit error correcting capability. It means if between transmitter and receiver 1 bit change by the error or by the noise, then the receiver can identify and correct. But if between transmitter and receiver 2 bits are changed, or there would be error in a 2 bits, then receiver is failed to correct. So this is the error correcting capability, you can understand here. So error correcting capacity basically defines the number of bits this code can correct. Now if we want to improve the error correcting capability of this code, then we have to go with very other complex code, or we need to add more number of check bits, which finally increase the redundancy of your code or decrease the code efficiency, that we will see it later stage in the same lecture. Okay, so now the next one we discuss is about we can obtain more this is a simple error correcting code where we can correct up to only single bit error, but this is not a optimum because we are transmitting a multiple bit, so we need a code which can correct the more number of bits rather than the single bit, but it can be obtained at the cost of a code efficiency. It can be increased, means it can be increased means the error correcting capacity. You understand here, error correcting capacity can be increased at the cost of a code efficiency. And the code efficiency can be defined the percentage of a useful bits or information bits out of the total number of bits. So we can say the code efficiency is eta, so it is k by n. This n and this n are different, and so I would like to change this equation. You may understand this equation would be simple k divided by n, where n is the code word length. So this shows the total number of bits and k is the data vector length. So is defined the information bits or the useful bits in our data sequence. So that is the 3 here. In our 6, we are considering the example of 6, 3. So n would be a 6 and k would be a 3. So if you place here 3 by 6 and we will get the 0.5, means the 50% code efficiency can be obtained with this one. So what is the redundancy? So r is equal to 1 minus eta, 1 minus 0.5, so 50% is redundancy. So what happens if we now increase the check bits from 3 to 5 or 3 to 6, we can obtain the better error correcting capability, maybe up to a 2 bits or maybe more. But at the same time, the code efficiency goes down because code efficiency directly depends on the useful bit divides the total number of bits. If the useful bits are remain same and the check bits are increased, then definitely this eta will goes down, and which decrease the code efficiency and finally bit rate, and at the same time it increase the redundancy. Both are not a good factor for a good coding scheme. So there is a trade-off we can obtain here. You can consider like the scenario, this is way you can have a code efficiency this side, and here this side you have better error correcting capacity. So either you get this one or you may get this one. So both, there is a balance condition where both are at the same case. So this is a trade-off. You can obtain the better error correcting capability at the cost of a code efficiency. Or if you try to improve the code efficiency by adding a less number of check bits at the end of your data bits, then definitely that you will suffer a higher bit error rate at the receiver. So this is the case. So error correcting capability can be boosted up by increasing the checks bit size m, but it increase the redundancy and decrease the code efficiency. So this one you have to note down. Okay, now how to produce a linear block code. So I repeat the matrix G here, what we have used earlier in earlier example. So this is the data vector D1, D2 and D3. This is a circuit where the code vector can be produced from a data vector, and the code vector can be considered as C1, C2, C3 up to C6. Now, first we can see this one is, these are the row which can be multiplied with the data vector D1, D2 and D3 consecutively, that the similar operations we have seen over here. So I'm not going to repeat. So this data vectors are multiplying with the individual element of a first column, then second column and third column and so forth. So basically this one is this one is multiplied with a D1, this one is multiplied with a D2 and D3, this one is multiplied with a D1, D2 and D3 and so forth. So this generator matrix G is given and we have to produce a linear block encoder. The question may be reverse also. Sometime you have been provided a linear block encoder, and from this linear block encoder we need to produce a generator matrix G, and which generator matrix G is used for a encoding and decoding process of linear block code at later stage. So we can see the first bits are same. So what we can obtain here, this C1 is basically same as your D1. So that can be direct line has been drawn. The C2 is also similar to the D2. So that is equal to D1. Similar line is drawn, D2. And C3 is even equal to D3. So there is a direct line has been drawn. But now C4 is obtained with the combination of D1 and D2. So what we can see here, this is my C, this is our C4. So for C4, the first element should be present is D1. The second element should be present as D3. And this element D2 is 0. It means it should be absent. 1 means present and 0 means absent. So in the column of C4, there are only two terms are present, first and third, and first term is correspondence to D1 bit and third term is correspondence to D3 bit. So we can combine this D1 and D3 and obtain the C4. So C4 is basically XORing operation between D3 and D3. Two lines from D1 and D3 are stretched out, giving an XORing operation, and then we can produce a C4. Similarly for C5, we can see here the first one is absent, so D1 is absent, but D2 and D3 are one, so D2 is present and D3 is present. So D2 and D3 line has been drawn from here, this one and this one. The C5 is produces a D2 XORing with D3. And in a C6 one, the first D1 and D2 are present, but D3 is absent. So you can see here the line is drawn as a D2 and this is D3, D2 and D3, right? Here you can say D2. That is my mistake. You can consider D1 and D2. There is a D3 and D1 and D1 and D3, right? Like this. So that can be obtained as a D1 XORing with D2. So that way the linear block encoder can be produced. Again, I repeat, sometime you've been given a linear block encoder, and from this linear block encoder you have to produce a matrix G with this combination. And then this G matrix G can be used for encoding and decoding process. Now the next topic is linear block decoder. I will try to address this next topic, linear block decoder, in a next lecture. So thank you for today.